Okay, so Abdullah, what we were discussing in the last class, I still have that program up in my system. So what we were discussing was how do we decide that a number is a prime number or not. So we discussed some looping and some if else in it. And we tried to solve the problem, then we tried to optimize the problem. By optimization, I mean that trying to make the process faster or mainly efficient. That's the whole idea of optimizing a thing, right? So today we'll discuss. Okay, let me share a whiteboard if I can. This is always ready. Oh, share. Okay, and let's see if my whiteboard is working. Okay, my whiteboard is working. Okay, so we will discuss today operator. Okay, my handwriting is bad. As you might be aware, I'm not as per a teacher for you guys. Okay, this is very, very bad. I'll just write it once again. Oh, okay. Can I write just OP for operators? Would that work for you? So by operators or by what do you call it? Mathematical operators, we already are aware of these, less than, greater than, and so these are something that you already know. Apart from it, we will understand equal to operator or what we call equality operator. So we denote it by double equal signs. Just put a comma. Okay. And okay, this is not really a mathematical operator, but this is a logical operator. I can just cross it out. We'll discuss it. And less than, if we want to say something is less than equal to, we say less than equal to by a single equal to operator and then greater than equal to and similar things like that. Okay. So if I write, let's say we can use these operators in our screen. Okay. Is my coding IDE visible or is it just the whiteboard you guys are seeing yourself?
Only the whiteboard is it?
Only whiteboard is visible. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Not really what I was looking for. Now my program should be visible, right?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Right. So if I use these operators, so what they result in basically are true and false. The either these conditional operators or these operators result in something truth or false. So we are discussing logical operators. Logical as mean what? So what is a logic? Logic is something which results in either something to be true or false mainly, right? We take a decision at that point. That's what logic is all about, to take decisions. So if I say, let's say if 5 is less than, let's say 3, which is wrong, but we can write it right. Then print wrong answer, something like that. And if you run it, it will simply say nothing because 5 is not less than 3. If I write, so else we discussed these in our last classes. So else we write print something, let's say right answer. Run it and it just shows right answer. If I want to print what this represents, I can just do this. And it rightly, and now it will just should say true and false. Okay, so it is false, right? How did it print false? It did it by first evaluating this statement. It found that okay, this is not true, so this statement basically becomes false. It jumps to else and it prints the output of this logical expression, which is 5 is less than 3, which is a false statement, so it represents false. I don't think there will be any problem up till now, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So rest of the operators work the same way. We generally use them for if and else, and we'll going through these mainly, or just if and else. Okay, now let me, okay, I hate this. Okay, so the other operators that are very, very important are like, if you want to say something is right, then you write. Okay, someone. Okay, again, it is you and me only. Okay, we'll see if RRP is joining back or not. Okay, so you are already aware of these, right? And operator, or operator, and things like that.
Yes, sir.
What does an or operator do?
Sorry, sir.
Or operator kya karta
hai? It's like comparing. It's like comparison operator.
No, it's not.
Oh, one second.
Yes, please.
There is it an identity operator or a membership operator?
I wanted an OR operator. OR. I'll write it on your screen. Yeah. Oh, you know this operator? It is not written as OR, but it is called an OR operator. Like this is an AND operator, right? You know this.
This is an AND operator.
This is an AND operator, right? This one. So what is an OR operator? What does AND operator do? Let's say you said that you know this. So what does AND operator do? Any wrong answer will be nice at that.
Like that symbol for AND is that? Like that is a symbol for AND?
Yes, is it not?
So because I'm not sure, because our teacher didn't taught us the simple. She just thought that was right, okay. Simply AND. That's why. Right.
Okay. So, just a second. Okay. Okay, so you did cover AND operator, right? AND.
Yes, sir, we covered.
Okay, so what does AND do?
Sir, it checks if both the conditions are true, then only it will go to the next block.
And what does the OR operator do?
It checks if like either of the condition is true, it will go to the next block.
Why would you need it? Give me an example if you can.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Keep your mic on, right? We are just two people in the session anyway, so there's no point muting it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Abdullah. So try to think of an example.
Yes, sir. I'm thinking of an example only.
Example for AND or OR will be any one of them. Will be for okay. You don't know. That is fine. You can say I can't think of it. That is fine.
Yes, sir, I can't think of it right now.
Okay.
If I write it, I can write and do, but thinking right now.
Okay. So I am not sure how your application works. As in the LearnEvo application. So what I'll do is we can think in that respect, right? Like you have a, let me just close this. Now, let's say you have a class at 4 p.m., right? And let's say What else? You have a test at. Somebody tries to add 4 p.m. test for you, right? In the system. This is already present. Okay, my handwriting is too bad, as you might have. It is worse than doctors. Anyway, so and now somebody tries to add a test for you at 4 p.m. Let's say you might you do have test on online, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So if I try to add it, so should I should have a statement in the system that first of all, no class. There should be no class, right? And or let me just okay. I make some mistakes. The reason being is that I work in different languages, so sometimes I write wrong statements. So just bear with me. All right, I work in different languages, so I sometimes confuse with different things. Okay, so no class. There should be no class. First condition should be there should be no class. Also, there should be no test at this time. Okay, and again I wrote it. Double ampersand. Right. So there should these statements both should be true for you for a new test to be added. If either of these statements are are false, like if you have a test at 4 p.m. already or if you have a class at 4 p.m. already, the system should not allow another test to be added at the same time, right?
Yes, sir.
So this is a very basic example on the system that you work on. So what computer science does, Abdullah, is it provides us some supplementary or interface to the user to use the system through technology, and it automates a lot of things for you. It solves a lot of problems for you. Let's say if you have what do you play? What sports do you play? I love sports metaphors. That's why I'm asking.
I play cricket.
You only play cricket. Okay. So let's say I have a team who is playing again. Let's say India has a match with Australia. Who has Australia, right? Now they have a few left arm fast bowlers, right? They have Mitchell Starc and they used to be Johnson, but I don't know. Right? Am I right? They're Mitchell Starc and he's left-handed bowler, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So left-handed bowlers have a natural tendency of swinging the ball away from left-handers.
Yes, sir.
Right. So what would the captain of the Indian team would decide is that if Mitchell Starc still has a lot of overs left, and I have a, let's say, left-handed batsman in my team already and somebody gets out, then I would not send the left-handed batsman into the main in the game, right? We would not allow the left-handed batsman to go out. You will choose a right-handed batsman based on that, you see. So you can automate a lot of things. If you have a system, so computer, cricket is not really a good example, okay? You can think of something else. Any other, you don't play other sports, okay? Cricket is fine. So, let me think of something. If I want to talk about ad operators. Where did you use it? What happened? Yeah, hi Roshni, can you hear me? Roshni, it would be nice if you can unmute and tell. Yeah, hi Roshni. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you have. Okay. Yeah, Roshni, you are here for the coding class, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You were present in the last class, if I don't remember wrong.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what we discussed in the last class is we discussed a problem called prime number finding problem, and we went through quickly this something. We discussed if else, we discussed our loop, we discussed some basic operators like modulo operator, and we use some lines of prints and things like that, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So what we were discussing today is what other kinds of operators are there, what other kinds of loops are there, and just go in detail with those things. So because control statements are your basic building structure for logic. If that is clear to you, you will be able to write good logic on your system. If that is not clear to you, then there will be a lot of problems. Like if you don't understand the control statement, like when to iterate over things, when to decide on something, when to do this, and when to do that, is why they are called control statements.
Yes, sir.
So, okay, I'll start fresh from you with you because apparently other people have left. Okay, so we were discussing AND operators and OR operator. So you have a background in computer science, right? In Python, if I am sorry, I can't hear you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you might have already studied these AND operator, AND operator, OR operator, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What does AND do? हिंदी में कैसे भी आप बता सकते हैं, कोई ऐसी प्रॉब्लम नहीं है. देयर इज नो नो रिस्ट्रिक्शन ऑन दिस, देयर इज नो क्लास, देयर इज नो एग्जाम दैट इज गोइंग टू हैपन.
एक्चुअली सर, आई माइट नॉट रिमेंबर दैट वेल राइट
नाउ. ओके, यू माइट हैव सीन दिस कंडीशन वन. ओके, पार्डन माय बैड हैंडराइटिंग. कंडीशन, ओके, आई जस्ट गेट इट. ओके, कंडीशन वन एंड condition 2, right? You might have seen something like this. Have you?
Yes, sir.
So what AND operator does is, it only returns true if both of them are true. If this and this are
true. I guess it's, if any of one of them is true, then it will just give the output that's true.
No, if any of them is false.
Yes.
Okay, I somehow selected this. Okay, just a second.
Yes.
So if I have any, let's say condition 2 is false, then the output will be false. As the name suggests, right? You only, you, when do you use AND as a word? If, let's say, if I am going with my father and my mother, that signifies that your father and mother is present. If any of them is not there, then that statement is incorrect, right?
Yes, sir.
So that is how and OR work. That is the basic idea of it. That is why we call them logical operators, because logically you use them in your everyday life, and OR. Or as the name suggests, it just does, if any of them is true, it returns true. If it any of them is false, then, and if one is true and another is false, then it gives true. If both of them are false, then only it returns false. So if I talk about AND operator, okay, if I talk about AND operator and I try to draw a, let's say, true false output, right?
Yes, sir.
So I write C1, C2, output. So if true and true, it will be true. If true and false, it will be false. It will be false and true, it will be false. Sorry, false. If true, I false and false, of course it is
false.
False. And for OR operator, if I make the same table, it will be slightly different. Not slightly, it will be completely different, but okay. So C1, C2, output. Again, we do the same true, it will be true. It will true, false, it will be true. Okay. And if it is false, so it will
be true.
And if it is false,
it would be false.
It will be false, right? So this is what conditional operators are. There are other operators of conditional operators as well, which are different. Like you might have seen these as well. You have seen less than. You have seen greater than. You have seen this one, if I am not wrong.
Yes, sir.
And you might have seen this amazing operator. Not. Right? You have seen all these?
Sir, I have not seen the lower one.
The not operator? You have not seen the not operator?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So how do you write if something is not equal to something? Like if, let's say, if your, okay, my mouse is playing a weird game. If your name, if I want to write, okay, let's write a simple code and you'll see how it works, right?
Yes, sir.
Let me just share my screen once again. Okay, yes. So let's say if your name, I'll just write name is equal to, let's say, Roshan. This is your spelling, right? Okay, if name, you know this operator, right? Equality,
yes.
Operator.
Yes, sir.
So if name is not equal to, let's say, if I want to say it is not equal to Roshini, then what I do, I print someone else, very basic code, does nothing much. And if I run this, it does nothing because it was able to find that name is equal to Roshni. If I just add an else statement to this, else just print it is Roshni. Right? So we just run this and it should say it is Roshni. So this not operator, what it does is it makes anything true to false or false to true. It just inverts the conditional value of it.
Okay.
Like, right. So if I write true false, we were having a lot of problems. Okay, you understand it, right? Not equal to.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can understand.
Okay. Okay. So these are some operators. These just help you to, just guide your logic. It's like you have to write a lot of conditional statements. Let's say co-vaccine, right? There's a drive going on for vaccination of India.
Yes, sir.
So it has some system. I assume there is some system running, right? Which keeps track of who is vaccinated, who is not vaccinated. So let's see what, we won't be running it, of course, but we'll see what the condition would look like, something like that. It's a pseudo code. I'm writing it in an ID, or I can switch to a whiteboard, but you'll see how it might look, right? So let's say it is, you are going, and let's say you are, okay, we'll see your, so you go to a center and they enter your Aadhaar card number or whatever ID they are using. What they find is, what the condition should be is, if Roshni is vaccinated, first of all. So if Roshni dot or is vaccinated, I just write if vaccinated, right? सबसे पहले करना चाहिए कि आप वैक्सीनेटेड हो कि नहीं हो.
Yes.
Right. अगर आप okay, pardon my curly way of writing. Reason being कि I'm not really a faculty. Okay, so Roshni is vaccinated. If Roshni is vaccinated, and what should I check else? That if Roshni is vaccinated, if it is COVID shield, if vaccine is equal to, let's say, the vaccine used is equal to COVID shield. So COVID shield has grace period, whatever you call that period between two vaccinations, two doses, right?
Yes, sir.
अगर इट इज कोविशील्ड एंड एंड वैक्सीनेशन डेट इज लेस देन व्हाट इज 90 डेज आर दे गोइंग विद 90 डेज दिस इज 12 वीक्स समथिंग लाइक दैट राइट सो वैक्सीनेशन डेट इज लेस देन 12 वीक्स वैक्सीनेशन डेट डिफरेंस इज लेस देन 12 वीक्स राइट सो डिसीजन शुड नॉट बी वैक्सीनेटेड राइट और वी कैन कॉल इट कॉल लेटर दैट वी विल गिव यू अ कॉल लेटर राइट
यस सर
इफ वैक्सीन अब द एल्स पार्ट ऑफ दिस इफ इट इज नॉट कोविशील्ड I'm just going with a scenario when the hospital just has Covishield and Covaxin, right? Covaxin has a different risk. So if vaccine use, if else it is not Covishield, so I can't just do with else. I have to write another if in it, that if vaccination date, I am assuming it is Covaxin, vaccination is, okay, just let me just erase this. This. Later on. So the else part of this will result in only two things, right? Either the vaccine used was not COVID, right? Or the vaccination date was not the grace period was not 12 weeks. So
it
the
else weeks.
Yes. So what we can do? Okay, we'll just go with this, and then we will try to improve these logical statements. It is a very badly written statement for now. So in else, now I have to check off two conditions. If, okay, why is this? Okay. If vaccine used is equal to Covaxin, and then I write if, and we'll see a bit following this, okay. Vaccination date is, let's say, let's assume the period to be 1 month. It is less than 1 month. So it says call later again. And else, if it is obviously Covaxin and the vaccination date is...
So we can give more than one else statement.
We can write any number of if else statement you want.
Yes,
is that a question? Yeah, aap pooch rahe mujhse?
Yes, sir, I was asking.
Okay, yes. So what we can, okay. If that is your question, so I'll just represent in a better way. And what I'll do, do you have any idea about flowcharts?
Yes, sir.
So we can represent these, almost all the programs can be represented in flowcharts, right?
Yes, sir.
So what do you need to check first? We need to check let's say I'll just write a flowchart, right? So this is a decision block, right? Vaccinated. If you're already vaccinated. So either we go yes from here or we give no from here, right?
Yes, sir.
If it is no, then obviously vaccinate. I'm using a process block, vaccinate. If it is yes, you're already vaccinated, and I'll just write a question mark just to denote that this is a condition. I didn't need to, but okay. If it is yes, then what I need to check? I need to check which vaccine. Right?
Yes, sir.
So I'll write vaccine. If it is either it goes to yes or either it goes to Covishield, something like that, and either it goes to Covaxin. Now, in Covishield, you need to check what it is. Period is less than 12 weeks, right?
Yes.
If this condition is true, that means call later. it's there, yes. Okay, what I do is, okay, this is a bad way of writing. I'll write this no because we are taking right-handed as no for now. No. Okay. Now let me just add this. This is Kevin. Kevin, who's Kevin? I don't think so. Okay. So, if it is period is less than 12 weeks, and it is no, that it is not less than 2 weeks, it is already over it, that means vaccinate, right? Again, or we can just take this to here. We can remove this, right? This is not needed. If it is yes, then call later. Where is call later? Okay, so I'll write a statement here. Call later. And this yes will go to here, right?
Yes, sir.
If it is co-vaccine, I again check. Our period is less than, let's say, less than month, right?
Yes, sir.
So again, if it is, I'll use this arrow. If it is no, if it is already over than a month, then we obviously, okay, better go. We will vaccinate, right? And if it is yes, then we will call later, right? So if you can see from the whole chart, we are all at the end, we are arriving at two decisions. Either we are going to vaccinate the person or we are going to call him later.
Yes, sir.
So if you see this one, the first statement that we wrote, this is the start one, right? So I'll just which is the start symbol. I think this is the okay. What is it going on? Start. So I put an arrow. So this is the first if statement.
Yes,
so,
sir.
So this is the else, right? The no will be the else.
Yes, sir.
So in else we go to vaccination. But if it is yes, then I again write an if statement, right? I again need to check something. So
yes.
this is another if. This is if. So this is what we call multi-level if-else statement. Like they will be cascading of if. There will be another if, another else. So what it does is, what if-else represents is nothing but this. Yes and no, right? It represents nothing else. It represents a condition which results in no or yes. Or true or false, we call it, this can be called as false and this can be called as true, right?
Yes.
So that is what if else does. It does nothing. So it, if and else can be inside of each other, not if and else can be inside of each other, but if else has a certain structure, but if statement can have a lot of if inside it, and same goes for the else statement. So
many else is inside it.
Yes. So that is how conditional operators work. So this is just if else. This is nothing else. We haven't even discussed what loop is for now. Is it clear that that if can have a lot of other if statements, right?
Yes, sir. It's clear.
Okay. Now we'll discuss loop for a little while. Okay, I can clear this, right? Okay, somebody has joined. Let me just get in touch. Okay. Yeah. Hi, Devin. Can you hear me? You haven't connected to. Yeah, Devin. Hi. Can you hear me? Devin. Oh, Devin. I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. Devin, it would be nice to hear from you. Okay. No, I don't think he's interested in talking. All right. So moving on, we'll move on to what loops are. So let me just clear this. What do you think? What does loop do?
Repeating one after another.
Repeating one after the other.
Yes, sir.
But doesn't that what your code does? I mean, it is executing one after the other, then while loop, by iterations. Like if I say this, let's say this one, right? Like I want to print, I want to print 1 to 10, right? To print 1, print 2, something like that. And I don't want to write like everything. Let's see what it does. It wanted to write. So I can write go on and up to 10, right?
Yes, sir.
So it is executing after one another. Why would I need a loop? Why do you think a loop comes into picture? You are right that it repeats a certain statement. It executes a certain instructions up to a point. We will discuss what that point is, but what does loop in itself does? Okay, so if I want to print up to 10 numbers, I have to write only 10 statements, right?
Yes.
Now let's say I have to print the entire name list of students in your school. Your school might have like 500 or 600 students, something like that. I am just being very humble about it. It might be more than that, right? So it is not possible for someone to write that much of statement. That's the first issue, that you can't write that many statements because that will take a lot of time for you to write the code. And second of all, if another student come into your school, what are you going to do? Are you going to write, change the code every time? So what we do is here comes the loop to our rescue, and we can reprint just print the same thing while, let's say, I is equal to 1, while I is less than equal to 10 or 3. We were going for 3, right? And we print I. And if I run this code, it is going in infinite loop. Why did this happen? Can you tell me why did it just kept repeating 1111111 and it just went on and on and on? Can you see a problem in it if you have studied loop?
So I cannot see your screen.
You could have, but okay. When we were discussing printing numbers, why did you not stop me back then? Okay, you can still see my who left. Okay. So I'll just share my screen once again. Okay. You can see this, right? Now you can see it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So very good. Good. So this is a while loop, right? So what happened is if I run this program, which is that I is equal to 1 while I is less than equal to 3, print I, right? That's what a loop is. If you have seen any loop, this is one of the very simplistic loop you can see.
Yes, sir.
Right? So if I run this program, what happens is it just keeps on printing 1111111111. Why do you think this happens?
Because there is no break in the loop.
Okay, let's where do you want to put the break statement? What does break statement do, by the way?
Stop executing the program after a point.
The entire program? Look, you can break out of an entire program by a break statement?
Yes.
No. Where have you seen break statement, like in programs? Did you see in the loops or did you see in the switch statement or where did you see it?
Sir, after the loop.
In a loop, right? So where do you want to put break and how do you want to use it in this scenario? Let's say you came up with the answer as break. We can discuss it, right? So where do you want to put it?
Sir, after print.
After print. Okay, let's do that. Why not? I'll just write break statement, right? And I'll just run it. What does it do? It printed 1 and it just broke out of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So why do you think this happened? This happened, okay, I'll just explain this one to you. So it tried to print something which I, which is, has a value of 1, and then it just broke out of it, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what does a while loop do in itself is, while statement executes the entire block of code below it, and then not yet, I mean, you know that Python runs with the indentations, right? Like this tab represents that this print and break are part of while loop.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And if I print something here, let's say my name, and then it, this is not part of the while loop. This is entirely different from it. So it just executes it after executing the while loop. That's how it works. The
yes.
problem with this while loop initially was that why is this condition used? Okay, another question. Why is this I less than equal to 3? What does this statement do?
Sir, it checks if the given number is greater than or equal to.
It checks. Okay, there's a lot of noise from somewhere.
Sorry, there's no noise coming.
There's a lot of noise coming from somewhere. I'll try and mute. Okay, that is from you. Yes, try unmuting it once more. Let's see what happens. Okay. Try rejoining the not the session audio. Can I rejoin the audio from the left hand corner? You can, yes. Okay, now we can try unmuting it. Yes, much better, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is just a conditional statement as we discussed earlier, right? Less than equal to is a conditional of it.
Yes,
what
sir.
What does while do? The while says, thus, until and unless this statement is false, keep repeating or keep executing these instructions. So this statement has to become false for this loop to complete its execution or stop. Or the other way around is to use a break statement. But break statement doesn't make any sense here because then it will just stop. So we'll remove the break statement. The problem here was that I will never become less than, I will always be less than equal to 3, right?
Yes.
I has never changed in itself. In itself, the variable I always has value 1 and it is still has value 1. So we need to change this value. As you might have seen with for loop, okay, you might not have seen with for loop in the Python, but okay. So we need to change I's value. So what we do is I is equal to I plus 1. Let's say we do, okay. Okay. So what we do is we add 1 to the I and then reassign it to I, so I values changes. Now if we run this code, it should print 1, 2, 3, and then of course AJ was anywhere there. Now do you understand how while loop works?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we'll write a very simple program. We did this program in the last class as well, and we'll do this today too. And you will understand where break statements are very important. Okay, so what we discussed in the last class was that we had a problem called to identify if a number is a prime number or not.
Yes.
That was, you might have done this program already.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what was the logic? You must have used break statement in that. There is no way around it.
So what?
You, aapne usme break statement use kara hoga.
Yes, sir. We used the break.
Because there is no way around in that program to skip break statement. You have to use it. Okay. So what we did is, first of all, we tried to get a number from the user. So what we did, number is equal to, of course, we needed to do this because we want the input to be typecasted to integer. It will, otherwise, it will come as a string and it will not work. Enter the number. Right? Now we have a number which is an integer. Now as I know that you will be already aware of it. So what we need to do is we need to run the loop up till the number minus 1, right? That was your logic in school?
Yes, sir.
Right. So what we do is if num is, we use the while loop, why not? While So I have to think what I need to use for while statement. So what I need to do is, first of all, I need to find another number. We need to divide num by some number, right? And then we can find out if the number is divisible or not. So we need to find the other number. Like, we need to do this, right? We need to do m this or a num. We need to find, you know this operator, modulus operator?
Yes, sir.
What does it do?
So it
it just gives you the remainder after dividing the left hand number from the right hand.
Yes, sir.
Right. So it just gives the remainder. So we need to find this n. We need this n basically. That's what we need. So we need n is equal to, let's say, because one is basically stupid because every one will divide every number. So we'll start n is equal to 2 while n is less. Okay, I'm writing this as a while n is less than num, right? It will automatically result in n being equal to n minus 1, num minus 1.
Yes, sir.
If num modulo n, I'll just put spaces, is equal to 0. That means if the number is dividing it, right?
Yes, sir.
Then we print, let's say, what does it mean? Not prime, right?
Yes.
And else, if it doesn't do anything, do we print prime?
Yes.
Are you sure? Okay. Why not? Why don't we try running it as usual? So we'll try running it. It will say enter number. Give me a number. Any number that you can think of.
45
is not a fine number. So it just goes on and on and on. Again, we made the same mistake, right?
Yes, sir.
We didn't change n. So what we need to do is n is equal to n plus 1, right? Now we run this program again. Now we use 45, right? So it says prime, 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 prime. And in between it said not prime. When did it say it? It did say a lot of time. Okay, this is weird. Okay, it can be divided by 3 as well, right? So it said when the value was 3, I'm assuming because I'm counting it, and it said when the value was 5, right? So this is not our correct program. We need to, the moment we find a number is not a prime number, we break out of it. We need to break out of it, right? That's where the break statements come into picture. When you need to stop the loop because you have found the stopping statement or the stopping condition. So the stopping condition is if you can divide that number with any number, that is the moment that you stop. So we need to break out of it right here. Now let's rerun it once again. It's still not complete, but we'll see. 45, again, it says prime and not prime. Why did it say prime? Because the first number was, let's print when it is saying prime and when it is saying not prime, right? So we print current number used to divide is, how do you write it? Or I am writing this many long lines. We'll write n, right? And in this case also, we'll print n. Now we run it. This 45 again. We'll use the same state. Okay, 456, my bad. That was like very easy, 45. So it says for 2, it is writing prime. For 3, it is writing not prime. Because on 3, it found a break statement, so it broke out of it. That's what happened, right?
Yes, sir.
So what we do is, first of all, this is correct. When it is able to find that it is divisible by some number, it is fine to break out of it. It is fine to print it is not a prime number. This else statement makes no sense. Because if it is not divisible by a certain number, doesn't mean that it is not being not divisible by some other number, right?
Yes, sir.
Or if it is not divisible, so what this else statement makes no sense. First of all, if I run this program now, what I see is, if I write 45, it says not prime at least, right? It is divisible by 3, it is a not prime number. But let's say I put a prime number here, like 11, 11 is a prime, right?
Yes, sir.
Now it is not able to do anything because it has no coding block to represent when it is, it has found a prime number. So what is the solution here? The solution here would be a good solution. Or can you think of a solution?
So the first of all, the else statement is necessary if we want the like the answer.
Okay. Like, but the problem with else statement will always be, right? It, you can't print anything there because as the else statement, as this condition suggests that it can be not divisible by other numbers. Like 45 was not divisible by 2. So it can't print that it is prime number because it has not gone through all the numbers yet. Right?
Yes, sir.
So what we need to find is, we need to, this loop will execute and will get over one way or the other, right? Either it encounters this or it encounters this statement. We need to find which of these happen. So we can do it very easily. If n is equal to num, equal to num, right? This is the statement when the opposite of this is this, right?
Yes, sir.
So this is when it will find that it is a prime number. Because this is the only scenario in which the loop got executed successfully and it was not able to find any number which was dividing the number, and it has come to the point that the number that we are trying to divide it with has come to the exact number. So it is a prime number, of course. Right? So we do this, we run 45 first. We see it is a not a prime, it is divisible by 3. Then we, let's say 17 this time, it says a prime number. Right?
Yes, sir.
So this is where the break statement is a necessary thing. Like you need to break out of it when you hit a certain statement or certain condition. So while loop considering or we can write other things as well. Can we just write, okay, that will be fun. We can try that. I'm not sure whether it will work or not. And let's say num is %n is equal to 0, right? I remove all of this. Okay, let me just copy this part. I don't want to write it first. This is not needed because break statements are part of only loops. Now we are using the AND operator as well, right?
Yes, sir.
So if I run this, I am not sure it will work. Let me see. It says not prime and the number is 2. Okay. It is a not prime number. That is fine.
But it is not divisible by 2.
Yes, why this happened is because this condition became false, right? This condition made this loop break out or execute successfully and get completed, right?
Yes, sir. If it would be like, it would execute both of them.
Yes, it will try to evaluate both of the condition, and this condition became false, and as it was an AND operator, it broke out of it. Now the problem was, n was still not executed, right? This never be less than equal to 3 and this equal to 3. This n should be 3. Why is it 2? It decides with 2. Okay, I'll just try to debug it and see what it is. I'll just write n here. Just to print how many times it did get executed. 45. Okay. So, n, let me just, if n is divisible by, it should not be, so this is, statement is false, so it's, so I have written a bad statement, it should be this. Now it should be. Right? Okay, I can remove this. Now is it giving out the right output to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So we, as you can see, you can play around a lot with coding. We did it in in one way, one time, and then we did it the other way. We basically changed the condition. And,
so there are more than one ways to do a certain program.
Yes, there are a lot of ways to, when we move on to machine learning, you will find that there are a lot of ways to do machine learning as well. It's not like it is fixed that, okay, only this way it will work. You can do it other way, a lot of ways. What you have to do is you have to find efficient way. That's the major thing. So in this small program, of course, we don't have much, much optimization level, but we can optimize it. We can make it more efficient. How do we do it? Like, we don't need to run the loop for 4, 6, 8, and 10 if it is divisible by 2. Any number that is divisible by 2 is...
it's automatically...
automatically covers all the even numbers, right?
Yes, sir.
So what we need to check if num... Okay, I have this 2 is equal to 0. It will give me a warning because I am writing parenthesis, print, not prime, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, this whole code should come in else because this is already, okay, I can. Oh, shit. Yes. Okay, this whole code needs to be in else because if statement is true, then it doesn't need to execute any of these.
Yes.
Now, what we can do is, because now n does not exist anymore, right? So we do n is equal to 3 because we have already decided with 2. So, and we can increment n every time.
It can be 3.
It can be 3, then we move on to 5. We don't need to consider 4 anymore because we have already discovered that it is not divisible by 2. So it is not going to be divisible by 4 anyway. Right?
Yes.
So we have, just by a single statement of running this, a single check, we halved our running time. We don't need to execute it for n number of times. We only execute it for n by 2 times because we increment every time 2 numbers. Right? It still will give you the same result because it is still logically correct statement. We can still optimize it more if you think about it. And by thinking about it, I want you to think about this. Do you need to go up to num minus 1? Do you think if you are trying to find 57 is a prime number or not? I'm not sure if it is. It is not, I guess. 59 is a prime number or not, let's say.
Yes, sir.
Would you even try after 30? Would you try to divide it by 32, 35, 40 or something like that?
No, sir.
Why would you not do it?
Because if it's not divisible by half of its number, then it wouldn't be divisible by any of it.
Right. So you don't need to run it up to n minus 1. You just need to run it equal to n divided by
2.
2, right?
Yes, sir.
And in this statement, you need to check is greater than, of course, it should be greater than this, right? The opposite of this statement. It will still run the same. It should. Let us run it one time. Not prime. And and let's say what we tried 59, right? Okay.
57.
57 is not a prime number. It is divisible by 3.
Okay.
Yes. So now we have not just half the running time. What we have done is we halved this year and then again halved it. So we are going the half of that half, right? So we have made the running time, we have made it 75% more faster than what it was earlier. Oh, of course, you can't see it in this small program, but let's say you have running a huge code, then these small tweaks matter a lot, right? Now yes. Let's say, okay, we can improve it more, but there's no point because any number can be basically, it can not be divided with, if you're going in a sequence, let's say, let's say we have a number called 20, right? So if it is not getting divided by the square root of it, if you are going in a sequence, only if you are going in a sequence, that is a very important state. Why? Because any number, let's say num, can be represented as m cross n, right?
Yes, sir.
Now what happens is, if you're going in a sequence, let's say m has, you go 1, then 2, oh, okay, my bad, 2 and then 3 and 5, right? Something like, you're running in this way, right?
Yes.
If you have already covered the higher number on the left-hand side, you have already covered the lower number as well. Yes. N can be less than or greater than m, right? Now, greater than, less than part is already covered, because we have come in a sequence, of course. And so the best condition can only be if m and n are equal. So we basically decide that any number which is not divisible by is up to its square root, it is not going to be divisible by any other number up higher from it. Do you understand the logic behind it?
Yes, sir.
So that is how you optimize program. That is how you write codes. That will be very useful when you write machine learning, because machine learning does take care of a lot of data. So what we discussed, okay, we'll just finish up it in 5 minutes. We'll just discuss some machine learning just to be, okay, I'm confused because there was some other person who had, this was the first class. Roshni, you did cover our first class, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we have already gone through machine learning. You were in the first class or you were in the last class only?
Sir, I was in the last class, but I wasn't in the first class.
Yes. So in the first class, we discussed what machine learning is. So I'll just talk about it, not really write anything much of it. So first of all, we don't have much time. Okay. And so what we discussed in machine learning was what machine learning is and how are you already surrounded by machine learning codes. You just don't realize it much, and machine learning has become this hard topic that people want to know, but you are already using it. In your phone, you're using it as a fingerprint scanner. On your phone, you're using it as a facial recognition software. As well, your phone gets unlocked with your face. How do you think your phone knows that it's you?
Yes.
Right. How does your phone know that it is your fingerprint? Also, if you have used your phone from the start, then you must have seen that you do imprint your fingerprints in the system. You do give that information to the system that this is my fingerprint, and I put it in like 7 or 10 times around and in different angles so that it can identify in different ways.
Yes, sir.
But it does get faulty very soon. But with the facial recognition software, it is very precise. It is very, very precise. It always unlocks. Fingerprint might have a lot of issues because the hardware has a lot of issues. That when you put the finger on the screen, then the screen might be smudgy, or your hands might be sweaty, and you might have burned off something on your hand. The lines won't go away, but they will become black. So what machine does is machine finds patterns between an input and an output. That's okay, let me see if I had some presentation on it. It went through it. If I have it with me right now, it will be nice. just machine learning into advanced. Okay, I have to reshare my screen once again. Okay, you can see this. Okay, so Yanda, we went through this. So as we discussed, machines are everywhere, and almost everything has some technology or machine in it right now. Even your headphones has a lot of processors now. We discussed what we're learning, and I wanted to go through this one. Okay, so this is how a machine. You can see my screen, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is how machine learns. What we feed the data is, we feed the data to the machine that this is Apple, this is how Apple looks like, this is how a strawberry looks like, and we label it, right? We tell the system that this is Apple, this is what you did when you trained your phone, that this is me, this is my photo, right? And you basically labeled yourself. You told the machine that that this is you and this is the master, and you should do unlock when you see this face. So what we do is we feed the system a labeled data like Apple, Apple, Apple. Now it can identify whenever it sees next picture of Apple or strawberry, it will be able to identify whether it is an Apple or whether it is a strawberry. So this is our supervised learning. When we tell the machine what it is, the machine doesn't, machine finds the pattern, but of course, on the premise that we have already told that this is an apple. If I say this is a strawberry, it will get confused. Because it has found pattern with a certain premise. That premise is no longer true. If we go to the other part, so there is supervised learning and there is unsupervised learning. So this is the unsupervised version, in which what we do is we input raw data to the system. Like a lot of data system, and it identifies different groups of data. So in this part, we don't know this is apple or a banana. This only comes into picture when we don't know it. As a humans, we don't know what that data represents. Like, let me think of an example. Like Tesla cars, right? Tesla cars use a lot of machine learning in them, and they have a very, very fascinating system running in there. Have you read about Tesla cars? Sometime?
Yes, sir.
So how do you think it decides whether to go right or left and things like that? This is the last slide. We'll just stop after this discussion for today.
Okay, sir.
So what have you read about Tesla car?
They are working on they have worked on a anti-crashing car that doesn't crash.
Again, there's a background. Please deactivate voice and then activate. Okay, yes, we are back.
Yes, sir.
No, we are not. Okay, now we are back. Okay. Is there some fan running at your end, or this is some problem with the software? I can't hear you. Yes.
Sir, actually, it's a problem with the microphone.
Okay. So, Tesla cars, I can't hear you now. Are you? Has it become good again, or is it you are not audible anymore?
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Okay, so what Tesla car, it doesn't just do anti-crashing or not crashing into system. It is an auto self-driven car.
It also has.
Yes, it is a self-driven car. That's a fascinating thing, no?
Yes, sir.
That a machine can drive on its own. And it can learn. You learn driving on your own, right? You, as a human, you synthesize a lot of data. You see a lot of things. Like a pole is coming, you turn right because you know that you can do it. Even while running, which is very implicit to us, we do this. We learn things. We know that, okay, if this much power, if I jump with this much power, this is much far I'll go. Right? To play a sport, you're doing a lot of calculations in your head. You're not aware of it, but you do. Okay, we did discuss what kind of sport do you play. You mentioned football last time, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So in football, right, you have seen players. So they move in a almost science-defying movement, right?
Yes, sir.
So do you think they learn it from somewhere? No, they have this, you have this special machine in on your head called your brain, which yes. can synthesize a lot of data. So they can know that. So if you can think of the amount of information that we need to process in that micro of a second to take that decision, it's a humongous amount of information. That which player is where, how much speed I have to kick it with, where do I have to kick it, how much curl it should take, and a lot of things. And we just know it, just like that. So yes. we identify faces like that. If I can see your face or you can see my face, you will identify me anywhere, right? On online network, not in physical, because physical looking at someone and digital looking at someone is a little bit different, but you can. If you have seen your friend once, you will be able to see your friend and identify him for a long, long time, even if you have not met him or her for like 5 years. You'll be able to identify. You know how to do it, but you know you can do it. You don't know how to do it. You don't understand the
mechanism, the process that.
Yes. So what machine does is machine says that everything is a pattern. Everything has a pattern. Everything is done based on some pattern, some relations, or critical thinking, what we call it normally. So what it does is, if you label the data, like we were discussing supervised learning, what it does is it identifies the patterns between it. So if we feed a lot of faces of you, it identifies the pattern between your face and other face. Okay, this is a different set of features. And our face has a lot of information, but we just don't know how to synthesize everything differently. We know we can do it. That's it. So that's where that's what machine did for Tesla. Right? People drove in that Tesla for a while and they were humans that were driving and machine was learning from it. Okay. When it did this, this much of turning of steering resulted in this. So now it can calculate it more precisely. Our machine is always more precise than people. Like for now, in the current scenario, a machine can identify a face more accurately than a human can. Like
yes.
that's our truth, that a lot of people think that machine will not be able to surpass you, but machine can find details which you don't, and once it knows how to do it, it becomes more accurate than you, because it is obviously a focused thing. So we'll go into machine learning, we'll see how these facial recognition software works. So not really the details of it, because those are more mathematics and pixelations and graphics of it. So we will not be going in details, but we'll be doing something related to it. Like we might try something of putting some colors to your eyes or something like that. That would be
yes.
Right. So how these filters work on your Instagram and everything, you'll find that all these is just machine learning, nothing else. It knows where your ear is, where your eyes are, where we can have a very small program and it can show where your eyes are in a moving video, where your eye is, where your nose is. So those are the benchmarks of a face, right? You have a nose, you have a mouth, you have eyes. That's how it differentiates things.
Yes.
So we'll go through that. And hopefully you will keep joining us. And next time we'll discuss some functions in Python. And then we will move on to classes, and then we'll come back to some simulation pack. Let's cover up Python for a while, because you have to choose some language to work on machine learning.
Okay.
Right? Okay. Good night. Have a good week. We'll see you.
Thank you, sir.
You're most welcome. All right. Bye-bye.